Thus far, the creation story of Genesis has failed to parallel the findings of modern science, if read literally, as the authors penned the narrative. But attempts to force-fit the story with these findings by reading the text too loosely have also met with less than success. On day four of the tale, more trouble awaits those who wish to find Genesis, an accurate account of prehistory.
And God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs, and for seasons, and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth, and to rule over the day and over the night, and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day.
Day three saw the instant creation of the plants of the land, specifically including grass, herbs, and fruit trees. But not for another 24 hours did they receive their first kiss of light, their first embrace of warmth. Had creation followed the path defined in Genesis 1, we now know the vegetation created before the sun would have perished the instant it was laid down. Genesis mentions no miracle of God preserving the plants until day 4 when the sun finally arrived to sustain the planet, so we can assume none was performed. The plants, had they been created 24 hours before the introduction of the sun, or even a fraction of a second before the creation of the sun, would have died in an instant. The intense cold would have destroyed their cellular structures, rendering them incapable of life. But beyond this elementary school observation, Genesis got far more wrong on the fourth day of its creation story. Science has discovered that the sun formed long before any of the planets of the solar system.
Our own nebula began its collapse 4.6 billion years ago. It's likely that the nebula had slowly been spinning in space ever since its formation. But as its material collapsed, it began to spin much faster. This is down to the law of physics known as conservation of angular momentum. As the nebula contracts, the same amount of energy is now concentrated in a smaller space. To keep the same momentum, rotation speed must increase. As our nebula began to collapse under its own gravity and spin faster, a dense clump of matter formed in the center. It's called a protostar. At first, its heat was due to friction, but when the clump reached 10 million degrees Celsius, nuclear fusion kicked in. 4.5 billion years ago, our star was born.
The planets, of course, including the Earth, followed the formation of the sun.
Within the clouds swirling about the infant sun, the planets are beginning to take shape. And today, scientists are beginning to understand the astonishing processes that formed them. For years, the process of planetary formation has puzzled scientists. Some astronomers now believe planets grow within the disk of gas particles surrounding a newborn sun. But this material is spread too thin for gravity to pull it into clumps. Then, in 2003, some informal experiments on board the International Space Station shed some light on this long-standing mystery. Astronaut Don Pettit spends his free time in space, conducting a few experiments to see how particles behave in zero gravity. He takes different grains, such as coffee, sugar, and salt, places them in pouches, and watches as they begin to attach to each other. He realizes that the friction between them as they rub together inside the pouches is creating an electrostatic charge that pulls particles together and forms them into clumps. It's a process known to planetary scientists such as Jack Lissauer as accretion.
We see signs of accretion in our daily lives. Raindrops condensed as very, very tiny droplets around small little pieces of dust and they collide with one another as they fall, in much the same way that grains collide in the solar nebula and accrete into bigger objects.
Once the clumps reach the size of mountains, they exert a significant gravitational force. It's more powerful than the electrostatic force, so the whole process accelerates fast. In about 1 million years, the clumps can grow into larger planetesimals, or pieces of planets, and can keep on growing into full-size planets.
With the Sun first and planets following after millions of years, Genesis is again shown to be completely wrong in its description of the formation of our solar system. But we're not done yet. Genesis also asserts that, like the Sun, the Moon was placed in the firmament as a light. But the Moon is not a light, but a reflector. The relatively smooth surface of the Moon is able to reflect sunlight back onto the Earth. But the Moon is also believed to have been born from a violent collision with the Earth during the early formation of our solar system, not hung in the heavens as if it were an ornament on a Christmas tree.
4.53 billion years ago, the young Earth is on a direct collision course with an object named Theia, a body the size of Mars.
If we had that collision today, it would probably be the end of mankind. It would be the equivalent of many, many hydrogen bombs exploding on the surface of the Earth.
It's a world-shattering impact, blasting material with such force that billions of tons of rock escape Earth's gravity and eject into space. This material is captured by the Earth's gravitational pull and enters into orbit. Over a few million years, it amalgamates and becomes our Moon.
Had this violent collision occurred on the fourth day of creation, when Genesis asserts the Moon was formed, all life that had been placed here during day 3 of the Genesis creation account surely would have been annihilated. And then there are the stars. Genesis asserts that it was not until this fourth day of creation that the stars were placed by God in the firmament surrounding the Earth. However, we know from our previous investigation of the formation of the universe that stars began to form some 200 million years after the Big Bang. That is billions of years before the formation of the Earth. Stars had long been in our universe before our own star, the Sun, formed. Furthermore, the Genesis creation story is asserting that the cosmos was made specifically for humankind's benefit. The Sun, Moon, stars, and other planets are placed in the firmament for light and for, quote, signs and seasons. But stars and entire galaxies existed long before the Earth. Like the Roman commentator Cicero, who remarked, "Again, the revolutions of the Sun and Moon and other heavenly bodies, although contributing to the maintenance of the structure of the world, nevertheless also afford a spectacle for man to behold. For by measuring the courses of the stars, we know when the seasons will come round. And if these things are known to men alone, they must be judged to have been created for the sake of men." The author of Genesis and his ancient audience saw the world and the universe as existing solely for them. The universe was a tiny place, just large enough to hold the Earth and her inhabitants. The ancient author and his audience had no concept of our universe as it really is. The author was doomed from the start to get much of his creation story wrong. So a literal reading of the Genesis creation story continues to reveal detail after detail of what the biblical writers got wrong regarding the birth of our universe and the formation of our solar system, our Earth, and life upon it. This dismal track record, recognized for its failure to accurately reflect the discoveries of modern science, is why some authors seek desperately for a way to reread, reinterpret, and rewrite Genesis in order to force-fit it with these modern views. In part 8 of this series, we will look at one of these attempts to retrofit Genesis with modern scientific understanding and see if there is success here in rescuing the Bible away from what Genesis got wrong.